Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, and welcome, wherever you are in the world. My name is Jeff Coxon, and I'm the European Advisor to the Medical Tourism Association, the MTA. For those who are unclear with the association, the MTA is a non-profit organisation, the largest of its kind in the world, and it aims to offer patients travelling for treatment the best healthcare experience through transparency, through engagement and education with healthcare providers, local and national governments. Its head office in Florida, USA. It's a member-based association with 300 members, and it has representation in over 100 countries. It is a true global voice in the medical tourism industry. The MTA also hosts the world's largest medical tourism conference. It's an annual event. I'm used to attending many conferences where there are around 200 to 400 attendees. The 2013 World Medical Tourism Conference had around 2,500 attendees. It runs in parallel with a global healthcare congress comprising employers, insurance companies, bringing buyers of healthcare together with suppliers of healthcare. There is also a ministerial summit where ministers from around the world gather to strategize on medical tourism and other healthcare issues. There are smaller summits and forums, and in 2013 we introduced an EU forum, which was a round table event. It proved very popular, and 2014 will see an EU summit at this year's conference. Any of you out there who are interested in attending or indeed speaking, then I would love to hear from you. So, I'd like to talk today about the EU Directive on Cross-Border Healthcare. So what are we talking about? What is it? Well, we are referring to EU Directive 2011/24/EU. And this states that as a citizen of the European Union, you have the right to travel, work and live in any of the 28 member states, and that includes the right to medical treatment as long as you meet certain criteria. So does this give an EU citizen new rights that they didn't already have? Well, the answer is no, it doesn't. There is a lot of misconception. The European Court of Justice has already established that EU citizens have these rights. However, few EU citizens understood just what that meant. The EU directive is a framework. It's not an introduction of new rights. It's a framework on how to exercise those rights. It was proposed in 2008. Became European law in April 2011 and was to be ratified by 25th of October 2013. The period 2011 becoming law to 2013 being ratified is there to give member states time to put in place processes and new laws where they needed to conform to the directive. So, the criteria to use the directive, it covers state treatments only. And that's important because when we look at the medical tourism market in Europe, it's actually dominated by cosmetic surgery and dentistry. And these are generally treatments not offered by the state. Also, patients must not have been able to realize in a reasonable time period, healthcare treatment in their own home state, and also costs must not exceed, in the destination state, those in your home state for that treatment. Now, a question has arisen on that clause because I get asked a lot, can a patient make up the difference if the price of the treatment is more expensive in the destination state that they wish to travel to? Well, the answer is the directive doesn't actually rule on that, and in all likelihood that will come down to the discretion of each member state whether they will allow that to take place. So is it as simple as that? Well, it's never as simple as that. EU directives are rarely ratified in the form that they were proposed. Consider we are asking 28 different countries with different thinking, different cultures, to agree on a single issue. So, in order to get directives ratified, there is significant renegotiation that goes on. And in the case of the cross-border directive, here are some interesting ones. In the proposal for the directive, patients were not going to deal with the financial side of the treatment. That would be something that once the treatment was agreed, the home state would deal directly with the destination state over. In the agreed directive, patients must pay for treatment and then be reimbursed by their home state. Travel and accommodation costs are not reclaimable, and we have to also consider that most medical tourists travel with either a friend or a spouse or even a family, and their costs are most certainly not reclaimable under the directive. The time frame for reimbursement is fairly unclear. There is no definitive time frame for this, and each member state will have to make their own definition. And then there is the definition of reasonable time. Member states have to state what they are actually defining as reasonable time, and a lot have not. Here in the UK, they have. Our Prime Minister, David Cameron, has stated that reasonable time period is 18 weeks after diagnosis. So let's dig a little deeper. This is an interesting clause, this first one. Patients cannot be treated in preference to a home country patient. Well, let's consider the UK again. We have a national health service. At present, we have around 2.5 million people waiting for treatment from that service. We have over 250,000 patients who have been waiting longer than the reasonable period of 18 weeks. That list is not going to go away. So, does that mean that there can be no inbound patients to the UK because they cannot take preference over a home country patient? Well, we shall see. In almost all cases, pre-authorization is required from the home state. You cannot simply get on an aeroplane, travel to another country, have treatment, pay for the treatment, return to your home state, and then expect reimbursement. You must get authorization from your local healthcare authority. Home states will not recommend overseas healthcare providers. They will not recommend destinations. They will not recommend specific providers. Patients must do that research themselves, and patients must make that decision themselves. Home states cannot be sued if something goes wrong. If something goes wrong, then the patient must deal with the healthcare provider in the destination state according to their laws. Member states are required to provide contact points. However, we must bear in mind, these contact points are required to provide transparent local healthcare information, not destination information. If you're a UK patient wanting to travel to Spain for treatment and you require some information, you must contact the Spanish contact point, not the UK contact point. Aftercare will normally be within a patient's home country healthcare system. So after your treatment, when you're able to travel home, you do so, and your home healthcare system will look after your rehabilitation. Now, this may change in certain states. Certain states are looking at the feasibility of patients actually staying in the destination state and being rehabilitated there with the home healthcare system paying for that rehabilitation. Why are they looking to do that? Because for a lot of them, they think they could save costs and also put less strain on the home healthcare system. So, ratification day, October 25th, 2013. What happened? Well, pretty much nothing happened. But that's not unusual for an EU directive. Is it the day that Europe forgot? Well, not really. We have to consider what's going on in Europe. Economic climate. We know there have been problems in Europe. There have been bailouts, famous bailouts, to Cyprus, Ireland, Portugal, Spain, and others. There is political turmoil in a number of the member states. And a number of the states have had to make cuts to public healthcare spending, affecting their local population. Quite simply, governments have more important things to worry about. Will the European Commission act for the failure to ratify this directive? Well, we're therefore talking about trying to prosecute a country that in all likelihood no longer has enough money to provide health care for its own people. Well, the reality is that would be a drawn-out affair. It would be very tedious. It would probably go to appeal. It would be a pointless exercise. It's not all doom and gloom. The vast majority of EU countries are in agreement with the principle of the directive. They're just not in any hurry to do much about it. Possible new members could slow things further. Albania, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Iceland, Kosovo, Macedonia, Serbia, Turkey. If any join the EU, they will have to ratify the directive, but they're most certainly going to ask for time to put processes and new laws in place before they can do that. So, while this ratification process is going on, how can healthcare providers gain a competitive advantage? Well, the answer is plan for the future. Look at the factor conditions. Involve related and supporting industries. Medical travellers are likely to need pre-consultation. Could you set up a partnership in the home state? They're likely to need an airline. They're likely to need accommodation. They may use a local agent to look after them while they're in the destination country. Look at the demand conditions. Manage your expectations. What is the market offering and what are you looking to achieve? You need a strategy. You need a structure. And don't fear rivalry. Concentrate on what you are good at to attract patients. Do not try and tell patients you're the best at everything. Rivalry can be healthy competition. Medical tourists normally have three things on their mind in considering providers. First and foremost, and that is cost, availability, and quality. If we look at a patient exercising their right under the EU directive for cross-border healthcare, if the cost has been agreed, well, that's not really a factor because you're going to be reimbursed. If we look at availability, well, if you don't have availability, you're not going to be considered just by the very nature of the EU directive. So it really does come down to quality and, more important, continuous quality improvement and communicating to a patient that is what you're undertaking. The MTA have solutions to help with this. Certification programs, training programs, measurements help. If you're not measuring quality, how can you convince a patient that you're continuously improving that quality? So what will the effect of the EU directive be on medical tourism in Europe? Well, the honest answer is nobody really knows yet. It still needs to be fully ratified. And one important point, if we look at medical tourism, elective medical tourism, we are an internet consumer society now. We purchase many things, including our medical tourism, by researching on the internet. And with most purchases, we want to see that somebody else has made that purchasing decision. We want to see ratings. We want to see reviews. We want to see patient stories, testimonials. And the simple fact is that the EU directive is in its infancy. And those ratings, those reviews, those patient stories are just not out there. They will come. And when they do come, they most certainly should have an effect on the industry in encouraging others to undertake exercising their rights according to the directive. The MTA are very focused on Europe. We have dedicated staff addressing Europe. Stellan Pika is our president and executive director, and I, myself, am based in London. The MTA also engages in workshops throughout Europe to educate and help healthcare providers understand the EU directive, understand patient expectations, international patient expectations, understand how to assess and improve their quality. In 2013, these were held in Armenia, in Georgia, in Portugal. In 2014, we've already been to Cyprus, and we're hoping to be in Greece, Hungary, Spain. The MTA wants to bring new initiatives to Europe, new opportunities, and exploring the EU directive on cross-border healthcare and planning for its final ratification is most certainly an important factor in doing that. We want to give a fresh approach to medical tourism in Europe. But watch this space. As I said, time will only tell. Thank you for listening. If you have any questions, then please post them, and I will verbally address them so all attendees can share the answers. If you'd like to contact me after the presentation or in the future, you can see my email address on the screen, jeff@medicaltourismassociation.com.